Where are you supposed to be then?
Has an archive of stories that we've made over a number of years, something like 700 stories. And the way in which, so we've done on various projects, and it started off from the kind of Catch a Whales project in Wales.
And
there's lots of stories there that some of the organisations that we work with then end up reusing, and then we've obviously got the archive itself. We don't typically share those stories very well, even though we've got permission to share. We've recently hooked up with another project that started up in the area, which is a micro broadcaster. Who is about to launch 3BTV in the Glynneath-Gwent area. And that's certainly one avenue where to show the stories. One of the things I really love about the digital storytelling in particular is the authenticity, in that we do not edit the people's stories. You know, we work with the group within the community to help them put their story together. We obviously bring the technology along, you know, to enable them to record it and work with them, and you know, hopefully kind of like support them in the confidence in which to create the stories. You know, but actually, their own, their words, their voices, and there's something really authentic about that. Something, you know, much more so than ordinary news stories. So the other way in which we always used to communicate as
Like we're all going to watch it, so you decide where the audience is, okay?
I don't know how to manage it.
So, so I think it's about, you know, how do we, as a community arts group and other group and other organisations, so continue to work with the community to make those stories, but actually have, you know, somewhere for them to be shown. You know, local newspapers was always, you know, maybe the established way of having local news stories. But actually, you miss out just such a huge number of people from that media. In the same way as TV does as well, and as I said to you, used to kind of like work BBC News, and it always just occurred to me, you know, all of the feeds that you end up having in, and you know, journalism very much kind of feeds the top of and just leaves all of the other stories, and then you end up finding the editors then having a trend, deciding really kind of like the national news, which might or might not be applicable for so it's, you know, how would we go off and do that?
We were asked to apply for a fund for preventing violent extremism, which is a very contentious fund in Birmingham, hugely political. People were going, we shouldn't go for it, it's outrageous, we're colluding with the police. And I went, well, you know, come on, you've got to sit with the devil, you just have to find out how things work and be part of decoding stuff. So anyway, we went, long story short.
We don't need this.
You don't need them. Okay, well, maybe leave them in case somebody gets cold feet in the audience, okay? So what we did was we applied for it, and they basically said, you're artists, we want some positive images of Muslim people. And I said, well, for a start, the acronym is PIMP, so we need to move away from that quite fast. And what I said was, I think actually what's missing is conversation between Islamic and non-Islamic people, because there is no place for that to happen, there's no safe environment for that. So I persuaded them that they needed to find a platform for moderate Muslims, not violent, because the violent extremism, 20%, is an absolutely massive 72 sects, millions of different Muslims living in Britain that are moderate. So they went for it, and what we did was we created an environment that I now realised after Future Shock is actually a digital storytelling environment. So there were full length screens, and they're not square, they're in a shape like this to sort of echo religious or spiritual shapes. And they only actually activate if you go near them. Then there's a niqab, you go and stand inside a niqab and you listen to stories about the scarf. So it's a very visceral thing. The idea is you touch and you engage with it. And it's also a really low soundtrack to interrupt it, blah, blah, blah. Anyway, what was interesting was that the reason I made the space in a big circle was to invite people into the centre and use the exhibition rather than each other. So you've got the triangle, rather than going, why do you wear the scarf? And there was a media one and stuff. And what we did was, because we were in the mail, because I always try and do things in shopping centres, because I think they're really interesting spaces, and you get audience and they're not going in with expectations, so they spend longer with you, actually. So, because we're in the mailbox, we had the BBC, and they thought they were getting free diversity training. I'm really honestly cynical, they were thinking, great, because I think they that was great. So we had these female producers coming in, and these young Muslim women that I worked with had grown this huge confidence through the project, going, why do you use the same three guys to represent us? And they were like, what do you mean? So you get the radical guy, you get the moderate, and then you get the wishy-washy one, the self-appointed leader. Why do you use the same people? And the producers were saying, well, will you come on? No, she won't come on. Given that where the perception is that scarfed women will not appear on television without dad or husband's permission and stuff. So I think there's a sideways way of starting the debate of, because, you know, you're talking about a very, very tight vertical structure within news.
Mm.
And they're hanging on quite tightly at the moment because they're so afraid of what's happening with social media. There's been a really big article, 14-month programme done on the New York Times and how they're having to change. And they are probably the oldest and the most structured news kind of organisation in the world. And it's very interesting the kind of issues that they're coming up against. So I think if we can find between us and network ways of influencing, because it has to be influencing, somebody has to agree to things, don't they? Because there is such an aesthetic about, we'll do the kitten at the end, you know, or we'll do the old lady.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know, and that, so there's already an aesthetic in place. I know when I ask people for photographs, they do the Gazette pose for me. You know, there's the Gazette pose, exactly, thank you. I think it's about decoding and naming some of those aesthetics, if you like, and then trying to find ways to influence and do. Hello. So that's not really an answer. That's a concept that we're trying to constantly find new ways. Like we have dinners. We do digital dinners where we've got Boston having dinner, and we're having lunch here with two Somali communities. We've done digital dinners, which we want to do more of, actually. So, how we get them out, we're constantly reviewing that as artists. We've got a space with a kitchen, and we have a dinner, and we'll show some stories. And we'll interview people there as well, because everybody always brings a dish to the table. But also, I will bring developers to that table, and they think they're coming to an event that they're doing a coffee speech. And then I'll bring the community that they're developing to the table with them, and none of them know they're going to meet. And that's quite high risk, but then those are conversations and debates that are needed, and debates that are needed. And what we're doing there is we're actually getting people to tell their stories at the table. And you know, the interesting thing about those dishes, part of the process is that you bring a dish with you that means something to you. The suits always go and buy something from Waitrose. And the community always bring a dish that means something to them. And immediately, the table is literally turned. So I'm very interested in social spaces and using those to also tell the stories and use online to get offline. So it's obviously, this is very low-key and very kind of discreet work.
Mm.
You're talking about how do we get... But I'm wondering if there's some left-field lessons from the kind of work we're doing that we can use as transferable to think of a left-field approach to kind of getting up the vertical ladder.
When we had our shop, we had no Wi-Fi and no technology down there at all. So I made an analogue digital tweet desk. No, an analogue tweet desk, because we had to just use what we found in this shop. It was all found objects. And we set up some of the racks that had been used to display things in the shop, cut up some card and made parcel tags with string on the end, and asked people to write in 140 characters or less their response to this. We also had some artists come down and do a mapping exercise where they physically put up a map of Cardiff and ask people to come in and tell us on this paper map where they'd seen empty spaces. Mm-hmm. And it was kind of trying to use digital communication as a metaphor, but actually exhibit it. And I just think what you said is very interesting, because presumably most of your archive presumably quite unknown stories, is digital. And it's a very interesting idea to actually make it analogue in some way. Because what you're talking about, when you're talking about the exhibition in the mailbox, presumably that was in the mall space, was it? So very, very public space. And I'm wondering whether, although it sounds counterintuitive, one way of dealing with this is to actually make the digital stories analogue and do something else with them.
I think the process is kind of slow and steady. So one of the arguments I've always said is that, you know, for every negative story, you know, of an area. So for example, I'm living in Merthyr Tydfil, and one of the kind of issues of the area is that they're constantly trying to.
You've got an enduring old story about Merthyr.
Yeah, an old story about Merthyr. We're constantly trying to change that story, and. And so for every sort of like, you know, every negative exposure, you kind of want to, you know, counteract it with a more positive story, or a more realistic story, authentic story, you know? And I think that's really what it's about. It's being able to then have, it's not just about having one network now, it's about being able to kind of get out there with a number of ways of doing that. And I don't think it's the type of change that will happen overnight with the
But I think, I mean, really, I suppose, I don't mean to lead into my session, but, you know, there's an aesthetic, and somebody pointed out at this festival the other day, is that people are really obsessed with getting stuff online. Where's the celebration? And we always do. Really, what we do is we work backwards, is that we want people to come together. So we bring in 8 communities together. So we start off with the rich having their digital thing. Let me do this, you know, for the 3-Minute Heroes, we did this whole red carpet. And then the artists, what was interesting is we as artists responded to their stories that they made. And each one of them made a bespoke film that conceptually reflected their story. Which I don't know how many people have done that, but I want to know if other people have, because I need to connect with them. Then we responded to the material. They're coming back and going, you've upped the ante. You've upped the ante of the way of telling this. And now they're interested in upping the ante artistically. And I'm really interested in that because we didn't lose their voice on the way, but also I'm an artist and I can't stand it, so many people being artists because it's not true. I've spent, are you going to deny 25 years of me creating an important skill? You're going over and you can be an artist. Anybody can be creative, but I don't think anybody can be an artist. I'm sick of being told that that's possible by councils and stuff for 5 years. So what was interesting in that was this constant response, and now they're going out and they're doing digital themselves. Like the old Jamaican ladies. We've got old Jamaican ladies going, if the young people can do it, you know, we want to go on or not. We can do digital now. We are, you know, because they've got into stop frame. So they know how to do stop frame now, and they're starting to do it with their children. And then when they came to the exhibition and saw what we did with their material, they want something else now. They want another layer of learning. And that I don't know quite what to do with it at the moment because they have a bit of fundraiser for it. But it's interesting because they actually want deeper skill levels now. And then they really are the next wave of getting these stories out. So I'm thinking, what is it I need to do now? Do they need a local blog or a local blog sphere type thing, which I'm not good at? Lee is, but I'm not. To then take them to the level, because then they'll. Because I think that's their way of getting interested in governance and all the kind of the local government, the gov stuff. But I don't actually know quite what that looks like yet.
I think one of the things is how you use digital to bring people together. You know, get away from the fragmentation, because we get away from the idea that just because they're digital tools, everybody's going to be sat in front of a computer. I mean, I think there are some things out there. I mean, the Village of Bray in Lancashire, they've got community screens in the post office, the pub, and places like that, where you can go up and get all your local information. It's also got local videos on there. You know, it's a touch screen. You just go up and you touch the screen and you can watch it. You know, and
there's some schools that do it as well.
Yeah, and the Your Square Mile project is just rolling out community info points, and I'm hoping they're going to learn from that experience and do that sort of stuff. I'm not sure they are. But, I mean, one of the ideas I've had is that I'm working on at the moment is helping people to create stories, but then do them, you know, once you've collected the stories, do them like a touring cinema show, in which you invite people to an event and you have popcorn and all that sort of stuff.
Yeah.
Absolutely. I've been looking at mobile projectors and seeing, you know, how we could possibly use those in doing story trails. And so you kind of create the stories with the community, then you go back out into the community and actually have your mobile projector and start to kind of play them back. Or maybe even have a one whether or not you could layer with a performance piece as well.
And there's your partnership thing as well, because if you've got a parish church, most places like this have got projectors now. And a bit like that, what was it, Flicks and Stitch? I think there could be a whole, you could network, couldn't you, and go, okay, you know, what's your theme? And almost get someone to sort of gently curate, pick a word, curate.
There's another layer which is almost where, I mean, there are villages that are motivated and have gone to the lottery, and now their village halls are as good as small theatres.
Yeah.
And there are also the National Theatre now showing their performances on screens, like 180 screens. And there are, I went to one recently, you know, and we're, you know, 150 miles from London, 500 people in a £30 and £10. You know, £15,000, isn't it? None of that money's going to support anything local. It will support the venue.
I know.
There's nothing going to support live theatre. So the National Theatre, instead of touring now, is using technology to actually make a lot of money and supposedly get a lot of kudos, because that's what's seen. But for me, it's okay, but it's not.
It's reductive.
Performance. It's not theatre.
No, it's reductive, yeah.
And I think, you know, that same thing about motivated and well-heeled villages. We've got these wonderful village halls and technology in them because they've been the motivated ones and the articulate ones. Mm. Smaller communities who are more needy, you've got to buy to use your hall now.
Yeah,
there aren't
community
spaces where people can hang out and you can, and so clubs are all, they're either dependent on the
And there's always, this asset transfer stuff is...
And we're losing, where I live is not a big enough area, so we've got smaller towns that don't have it. Looks like we're losing completely our FE sort of resource. The local college has been bought out, and it looks like they're going to shift it and stuff. So young people are not going to have to go, an hour and a half to get any FE provision. Or they go to sixth form, but sixth form kids, it's a different model kids.
Yeah. That's a huge shift. That's almost as bad as getting a Tesco, isn't it?
Well, that's right, we are getting the Tesco, because that's the other thing. Yeah. And then, so there's that thing about where technology is, as usual, a corporate view of it, and it's doing what it wants. It's not giving more access, it's not empowering people in any way. It's just learning new ways to extract more money.
I work for Birmingham City Council. We've had it takes an hour and a half for young people to get to... from June last year to this year's intake of students, it's almost as if the north of Birmingham has vanished through various decisions that have been made nationally and locally. The young people of North Birmingham are choosing not to go into further education. And what I do in my day-to-day job is programme management of the school building and refurbishment work across the city. And we've approached schools and said in the design process, have one huge white wall outside. And they were like, why would we do that? Cinema screen rooms.
Yeah.
You can become a community hub. Throw parties, invite your communities in. But they'll have access to our spaces. Absolutely.
And it's the same argument with libraries. Make yourself relevant.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, but then you're getting into, are you colluding, or are you actually demonstrating that you absolutely can't get rid of us? And it's that. But it goes back to your very first thing, which is why I came to set up authenticity. What is the reciprocation? What is the exchange? And is it authentic? But don't ignore the fact that it may also be a really, really useful defence weapon. Do you know what I'm saying? It's how you be mindful of the spin, but actually the centre of it is absolutely authentic. authentic, and who's to make those decisions? I mean, I think we all know instinctively when something's authentic or when somebody's authentic. You get a real tickle for it, don't you? From, you know, and I think that is one thing that people will pay for now.
Yes.
And you can't create being authentic. You know, there has to be a sense of philosophy.
What the interesting thing about authenticity, and I think also that kind of also goes on to the form of
she's saying some really interesting things, you know. She really is. She really cares about people.
So we've been watching so much so-called authentic TV. It's not authentic, you know. The kind of like the whole idea of spin on reality is, you know, kind of needs to be turned on its head. And it's interesting whether or not the digital storytelling kind of like format, the aesthetic around that is trying to kind of oppose that type of idea. Don't know. We're going to check.
Where I live in Telford, it's part of a new development. They built Warrenville in Birmingham, and the kind of Quakers said, "We will build something else." And they sat and they waited, and they waited almost 100 years, and they said, "Like in Telford, we'll take some land there and we'll develop that into a new community, and we will model it on the Warrenville model." And it's really interesting. I have kind of latched onto a hyperlocal blog that started, that kind of grew out of some of the resident discontent with how things were moving forward, some of the problem parking, and we have to be really careful about the kinds of stories we tell about ourselves, because not only are we saying this is what's happening now, we are at the same moment creating the archive and the history. And I'm really keen for there to be the look, we gathered together and celebrated this. These are our community leaders now. This is how they inspire. This is their legacy. Because we're automatically creating the archive of we were here. This was the start. You know, I'm one of the first residents that moved in. And when we first moved in, it was like living in Stepford. Everyone. All the houses are very, very similar. Yeah, there's some differences. Absolutely. And for the first 9 months, everyone was suck it in, put on your game face, be nice to everyone. And it's just recently that everyone's kind of gone, oh, and they're starting to actually behave in ways that are authentic, and it's fascinating to watch.
Isn't that interesting? Because we always say with our practice, I'm not interested in truth, I'm interested in authenticity.
Yes, somebody absolutely.
Somebody might be a complete out and out racist, but they might, because they've probably got a set of assumptions that they have gathered ammunition in order to support. But that's still their reality. And I would never collude with that, and I would always call people out. But actually, there are authentic voices out there of white working class people that are not listened to. There are also, you know, Sikh and Hindu people that are quite, you know, quite put out by the kind of, you know, Muslimic, as Lee calls it, Muslimic obsession at the moment. Not from the point of view that they don't dislike their mates, but just the way that everything is focused on Islam. So there's this constant, you know, sort of reevaluation of, well, what is your truth? And so I think when you said you don't edit, I do believe you, but I think, you know, everything we do in our lives is a manipulation, but there are degrees and levels of what that manipulation is. And, you know, I'm always after seducing with integrity. I want to win. I don't want to just get a something. And I think that, you know, the news is very hard. Why? Because things have to happen so fast as well. But they just don't have time to sort of do the nuances, and because if they can't ring somebody and get them right there and then, they're not going to bother with the guy. They're not going to drop them an email. They're just going to, you know, fire on.
I mean, you talked earlier about the BBC and I think it's a huge myth about the BBC, you know, being independent and all this stuff. And I think the biggest thing that upsets me on the telly at the moment is you know that advert, these people leaning against buildings, and it's a very interesting series of sequence of people just leaning against buildings. And at the very end, it says, love your place, love your local radio. BBC tuned to, BBC local radio is hugely overfunded for what it does. And it doesn't give access, it doesn't cover, you know, in the same way the local news on the telly doesn't cover. It's, you know,
I agree with you. I mean, just,
I disagree. The local Shropshire radio is fantastically open to stories being supplied by the local community, but that's more about the presenters of the shows rather than it being a corporate decision. Right. Yes, we'll do that.
So is it a personality-led thing in different regions then?
Yeah. It might be. Well, I mean, I've talked to the managing editor of Radio Gloucestershire, and he says, I know what my listeners want.
Slap, slap, slap,
slap. That's bad.
That's terrible.
And, you know, and he's about mid-50s.
That's a shame, so you're not sorry to see.
They get $1.5 million a year for their budget, and that's a huge amount.
That is, yeah.
And they openly say their target audience is people 50 and above. So they're completely leaving out the younger generations and admitting that. And so they're getting away with it. But they don't even cover, cover geography.
I think the thing about BBC local radio is its audience is dwindling, and they're now talking about cutting it back so it's only breakfast time and drive time and everything else will be syndicated. And I just think they're sleepwalking into that situation. They're not doing anything about it.
They're not demonstrating.
They don't feel threatened. Yeah.
So their complacency, well, that malaise is actually going to impact our whole.
They fought for the whole
digital thing to have new radio stations when they were told by everybody that people stopped listening to radio. And thank God, because actually, local radio, I agree with you, but my life's much richer for 4 Extra and 6.
Oh, sure,
national stuff.
Thing about local radio, I mean, I made a point the other day on Twitter that I was trying to listen to local radio because I was interested in the story, but I switched it off because I found the music they kept playing really irritating and annoying. And I know, and I've been on local radio stations where the presenter has, I shouldn't say too much because you've probably traced it. I've been on local radio programmes where I've sat there where the presenter has to put music on and he sits there going, why do I have to do this? You know, because they have a playlist. And
the playlist based is based on what's safe. Upset people, they actually own a computer program.
Yeah.
And it is.
So is there something we need to do collectively to try and lobby for something? I mean, I know we all have a very changing relationship with time, like we never have any. But it, you know, is this
something? I think lobbying is something is quite interesting because, in actual fact, from the conversations we've had so far about corporations, whether that's a broadcasting corporation or whether that's a corporation for education, colleges, you know, it's about that complacency and the thought that they think that they're providing for the community and actually aren't. So it's about trying to kind of, and if they are, it's trying to get that voice from the community kind of like back out in order to lobby for change, you know, to put the big kind of white wall outside, you know,
Which is actually the focus of why Vicky got this together, which is the local kind of gov counselor, kind of learning, I guess, from an artistic community or something, about how they can not improve and spin better. I think you said it really well, but kind of not improve the aesthetic, but shift it so that people do go for it. But that they're looking at something.
I think that's right. I think we have. I mean, I'm involved in something called Better Culture, which is Better Culture, which actually grew out of the Peachy Culture. If you know about the Peachy Culture, we run it much better, we think, and it's we do this in Leeds and Bradford and Huddersfield, and it's spreading. But I actually think it's a different kind of entertainment because people think entertainment should either be funny or shocking, or you know, what those evenings do is about people communicating passion. And I think that's entertaining. You know, it's engaging. It's a different kind of entertainment. But I also think, I mean, one of the reasons why I got involved with the Big Lottery was, I don't know if you saw any of the Village SOS programmes. They did a series of programmes where they were talking about villages which had run lottery money to regenerate themselves. And I said to people at Big Lottery, I said, it was fine as it was, but it was television. And so what happened was, I would have liked to have learned a lot more about how those people went through those processes. But they condensed it all down into 1 hour per village. And they brought out all the things that television brings out. So it's the conflict in personalities.
The Rottweiler stuff. It's Rottweiler television.
And I would much rather have had it spread over a longer period and learned a lot more about how they went through what they went through.
Did you see that programme The Tower? That for me was the first shift that I've seen on television. They won awards and then they haven't done it again. It was about a tower block that was sold by Lambeth Council, right on the river. And they didn't, there was no commentary. It was over about 6 weeks. And they would just let people run to camera and reveal, because that's what happens when people... So there was the developers, and there was the people that kind of moved back after having given birth and the place had been squatted right next door. And just these, and the guy that's hoping that the pub, the news people coming, but he didn't have the right pub environment. There was some, there was going to be some losses in this regeneration, but it was so not Rottweiler.
Yeah.
And it, and there was more space in it.
You see, I think it's one of the things we have about community activity. If you look at the popular media depictions of community stuff, it's people like Hyacinth Bucket and Dad's Army and things like this. It's ridiculed. And if you seem to want to be putting things into the community, you're seen as a figure of fun.
But it's the same with all arts, though. Anything with the word community attached. Someone looks at a flyer for Heard and Not Seen, for a project we did with Islam, because we moved it into Birmingham Museum and Art Gallery. And it's this woman looked at the flyer and went... So did you do this with the community? I went, yeah. She went, has it got a community feel? And I went, are you asking me whether it's shit? And I went, because it isn't. Why would you associate working with communities producing shit art?
But you see...
But people do, actually.
I have a real bee in my bonnet about lots of television. One of the things that I really have bee in my bonnet is soap operas. Because I watch them, and they just make me so angry. Because they are about the basest bits of human nature, and it appears that you can...
Like golfing ripple, chip onto the green, young lady, and they're very impressed.
I watch them for 10 minutes at a time, just as research, really.
Yeah.
And it doesn't appear that you can have a soap opera storyline without people bitching at each other, or trying to do each other down, or...
Ever smile? Yeah. No, you can count how many smiles.
Yeah. You're not allowed to be positive.
I've never seen happy gay characters. I've never seen... They're always angsty, they're...
Queenie.
They're fighting. I like that at the moment.
Where's the guys that are into bears? I know loads of guys that are into bears. They never get that on telly.
No, there's never just a gay character going about his day. There's no one who's,
he's defined, the character's defined through his sexuality rather than his personality.
Yes.
Yeah. So these are all issues of representation.
Yeah.
And I'm just wondering whether... I mean, this is a question you couldn't possibly ask, but whether it's possible to move or separate representation and information, because one of the things that I think just doesn't get reported is things like council meetings, for example. Where did you last read or listen to or see a report on a local council meeting? Now, what happened in Cardiff?
Not minutes. I went, because I'm a parish councillor, I wrote up one parish council meeting, so took the agenda and then just through the meeting consciously annotated with all the stuff that kind of crawled across my brain and turned it into a blog post and then stuck it on the local community blog. And people just went, oh my god, is that what you talk about in the meeting? Yeah. Everything.
See, we had that in, and if you're from the Leeds area, are you?
I live in Huddersfield.
Oh, well, you might have caught some of this. We had a Guardian local blogger as part of this experiment that we did, and because the local newspaper responded with a similar community building sort of talk about local, but a commercial one, we actually did get more coverage of what was going on in meetings, because these people would sit and go to
absolutely
proper trained journalists who knew how to take.
Yeah, can I say that was a wonderful project? And if you're watching this, Guardian, why did you pull the plug on it?
I think we all think
they pulled the plug on it.
Yeah. Post hoc, they called it an experiment. I mean, the Guardian blogger, and if it's on film, it's Hannah Waldron. She was brilliant.
Lovely.
Because she, of course, was involved setting up the Bourneville blog. But, the work that went on in Cardiff for about a year was extraordinary, and it made such a difference in terms of the information that was circulating around the public sphere.
I think that's more to do with the individuals involved in the project rather than the project itself.
I don't know, the Leeds one was...
No, well, the Leeds one was great. Yeah. I mean, I was involved with the Leeds one, and it was fantastic, and say John Barron was really good. I mean, it was also being run by Sarah Hartley, who's a wonderful person. I hope you listen to this, Sarah.
Did you... so what has it you've been doing with the Heritage Lottery?
Sorry?
What has it you've been doing with the Heritage Lottery?
It's not a Heritage Lottery, it's the Big Lottery.
Oh, the Big Lottery, sorry.
Yeah, we are... well... I suppose ultimately we're looking to devise a framework whereby projects can use social media as part of their reporting processes. So it's not about dull reports that sit on shelves. It's about people telling their stories and the participants in projects telling their stories and the ones who benefit from them.
Yeah.
I think that one of the... I just made me think about experience of writing groups where everybody wants to have their piece of writing read out, but they're not that interested in anybody else, and they don't read other things.
Yeah.
There is a sense of building, so that like not everybody's story can be told, you know, and there's a sense of working together to say, okay, how do we make a story that really does work, even if it's our own and stuff? And I think it's the editing skills again.
Yeah.
It's that sense which is, you know, you're saying about having a proper... And people, I think, too often, it's like, oh yeah, everybody can take part.
Yeah, yeah.
But really, in the end, you end up with 400 kids reading out a poem.
Yeah.
Which is not a great experience.
No.
I think that's right, because what you were talking about the council meetings, I mean, you know, if you contrast, I mean, I know Leeds and I know Huddersfield. I mean, Kirklees Council are really good at this sort of stuff where I live. They like broadcast all their council meetings and cabinet meetings and stuff, and they put all their minutes online and everything, but that's a huge amount of stuff. I mean, not many people are going to sit and watch a whole live council meeting that lasts 3 or 4 hours. You know,
no,
so I think
but
what.
But do you think it's shifted people's perceptions of the council?
I'm not sure enough people watch it. I think it actually worked better in Leeds where the Guardian were doing it and mediating it and editing it. You know, and you could say they might, you know, some people might say there was a bias, you know, that could come into that process. But I think they were putting it into much more digestible form for the public than happens when you just splurge everything out there. And I think there's a role for it, and I think it should be done. Actually, I think everything should go out there. But it also needs editing for the people who haven't got the time or the inclination.
Or there needs to be some kind of almost like a GPS map. Okay, I want to find out about that meeting because that involved my area.
Yes.
With or whatever. So I need to be able to navigate
to
get there.
Because in meetings, things come up and you don't, I mean, things come up.
How do they get tagged so you can go, okay, what's
right.
going, what, who's been talking about Dingley?
By the way, people should be informed that something came up.
I mean, I people in my parish council view me, I wouldn't say it's suspicious, it's kind of curious.
Are you a curious freak? That's,
it's like you're putting all this out on the internet and you're letting people know, how is that useful? Is that all?
How is it not?
When I stood in the local elections in May, and almost nobody who did locally was actually really that interested. Most people have made up their mind on the basis of political colour rather than engaging with local people. When it came to count rights, there were people around the world who were more interested in my result than elsewhere in the country. There were people in Birmingham who were tweeting me at 3 in the morning saying, Ben, when are the results? How is it going? How is it looking? There were people in Washington DC tweeting me. And it was lovely, and then my friends were more interested in my result than they were their own results in their local councils. Which is wrong. That isn't how it should be. It's a lovely ringing endorsement for me as an individual.
It's not democracy.
They care.
But the people who are tweeting you from Washington aren't going to be affected by the results.
No. But they were curious about the process as much about...
I think you're doing a service there because you're opening up democracy, and I think it's one of these things. Like I said to you the other day about your train tweets. There will come a day when everybody in that carriage is on Twitter, and every time you tweet, they will turn around and say, "Stop it!" You know. But at the moment, they're not. So at the moment,
I'm scared. I have a genuine fear about the people I've tweeted. There are particular regular people that, if God, anyone in their office ever had was on Twitter and went, you get the 7:45 from Wellington, don't you? There's a guy who tweets the whole journey, and there's this woman that he describes as having hair like a Lego character, Lego hair, and it just, I fear that moment of when someone suddenly realises I've been tweeting about them for 2 years. And it's not out of snarky meanness. I have genuine affection for all of the people that I tweet about. I noticed.
But that's interesting because I've seen people bullying and I've de-tweeted them, and they're people with big reputations actually using it to bully on.
Mine's always about affection, and it's about I admire these people, and if they're not there, I worry. So there's a guy who, for a week, I saw him reading Chris Ryan novels every day for a week, and then I've never seen him since, and I always wonder about him, and I always look out for him in case he's... Because he would always sit in the same seat.
He's probably just got another job.
Yeah, different job, moved house, I don't know. But he was there long enough for me to notice him and name him. And
intrigue on him as well. Yeah. And I think it's intrigue that actually cuts the mustard between something. Mm. So, I always talk in art and theatre about making spaces, entry points for people. So, in a sense, yes, it should all be out there, but actually less can be more, because there's three positions people sit in. They're like, I could do it. It's not about or I'm in.
Yeah.
You have to move people from the half-hour expert to, I'm intrigued.
But I think this issue about who knows about what you're doing. I was going to talk about this afternoon in the workshop about young people, but there's a young Muslim woman in Huddersfield who lives near me. But I've only ever met her in London, actually. but she started doing a daily video diary. And she was being quite candid and intimate in some of the things she was saying. And I started to watch this every day, and I was starting to think, she's a young Muslim woman. I mean, she had talked about how restrictive her parents were in the video diary. And I just started DMing her on Twitter and saying, are you sure you want to say this in public? And she gets, my parents don't know what I do. And I said, they will find out. And they did. Eventually somebody else saw it and told her parents, and they stopped her from doing it. But she didn't think they would ever find out. The fact that this was open on YouTube, she didn't think her parents would ever find out.
Can I make a suggestion? Because I know times we really need to give
I think there's
no conclusions here, just being able to bounce off some people.
I was wondering about that. I think some of the things that we have talked about is about that kind of sense of the community, and I think that you, in order to make change, there is it's about kind of getting together with people who could help you kind of do that. Yeah. And there's also something else as well, which I think I've kind of gathered from the conversation we're having, is about not being complacent. On the trend, it's about being interested in what's going on and trying to
it's moving from being observer, storyteller, and then you become an agent of change. It's a very specific process, because whilst I'm tweeting about people on the train, I'm also campaigning about the issues of stateless stations, the car parks.
Right, you're doing a kind of parallel. Martin Mullaney can learn a lot from you.
Well.
I think certainly one thing that's going to come out from me today is actually to follow more people. Because I'm definitely going to,
But also, in my overt enthusiasm, maybe one of the conclusions today is, as well as following each other, just finding somewhere, maybe an existing club, rather than, where we can actually continue this chat, or even just phone each other once in a while. I've been practicing phoning.
How do you do that?
It's really exciting, because I've got a deal with all my clients now. I do not answer emails within 2 days. They go, because I get, you didn't answer my email. You sent it yesterday. I don't do, I'm out, I'm working. So maybe we can even phone each other.
You mean Skype or Google Plus Hangouts? That's what you mean, isn't it? Right, okay. I can handle that.
Can we see the show? Where would you like us to sit?
Where do you want us to sit?
sit, girls. We're going to watch a show now.